Welcome to the Sunset Music Club. We have Caleb and Nathan from the Kings of Leon. How are you doing?
Wonderful. How are you?
Great. How are you?
Yeah, I'm really good, thank you. Last time I caught up with you was in Birmingham a few years ago, and it was the show where I think someone threw a bottle of water and it landed on your sound desk. I don't know if you remember that.
Oh, and yeah?
The whole thing just stopped. Never seen anything like it.
Yeah. And you sat on the, you just sat there on the amp for a little while.
Yeah, I don't remember that.
The show stopped.
Yeah, I've never seen anything like it. But then your team were just, they quickly got a new sound desk in. I was like, that's amazing. Really cool. But you're back with a new album and a new huge tour as well, which you're sort of got a few days off in the middle of at the moment. Newcastle tomorrow night, I think. Walls, it's such a great album. How have you found it going down? You sort of, is it nice getting it out on the road and playing it live? Must be.
Yeah, I think we're all very excited and surprised in a way. You never know when you're making an album, you know, how it's going to be received.
Mm.
And I feel like while we were making this album, we were all very proud of it. And a lot of times when you're proud of something, it doesn't really go as far as you hope it will. But this is it's gone above and beyond. And the reaction, it's the first time we've ever had a new album that when you play the new songs live, it's like you've been playing them for 20 years.
Oh, really?
They go over as good, if not better, than a lot of songs that have been like staples in our set list for a while.
Uh-huh. And how, I mean, does it get harder writing an album? Because I know with the band, you sort of really nail that sound, don't you? That unique sound that you have. But does it get harder when you go, oh no, that sounds a little bit like that? Or do you fall into patterns with your chords or rhythms?
I think this record, it was our last record on this current deal. So mm-hmm. I think we kind of approached it like, there's no parameters for this, right? Just throw it out there, and if it sticks, great. If not, we can move on. And even while we were making the record, we all kind of had the same kind of thought of like, this is almost like a greatest hits kind of record, as far as like, no matter what genre of Kings of Leon you were a fan of, there's a little bit of something for you on this record. Mm. And you know, I think this record put us over 100 songs total that we've written.
Oh, wow, really? Yeah.
So by the time you've done 100 songs, it's impossible not to write a part or sing a line that isn't somewhat similar to something you've done before. Like, I don't know how Bob Dylan does it, to be honest with you. But, but yeah, we were all very, very excited. It's like a rejuvenation for the band, which is rare to have happen on a seventh record, especially.
Mm. And sometimes that's so refreshing, as you said. I mean, and with that, with sort of recording and working with someone comes different downtime as well, doesn't it? And what you do in your downtime and things like that. Is there any one moment or one day that will always stick in your mind when you were writing or recording this album? One particular funny time or reflective time?
I was having a little trouble, a little writer's block, because there were a couple of songs that they kept getting kind of stretched out a little bit. So I would have the song written, and then I would come in and realize that I needed like two more verses. And so one day I like called my wife and I was like, I'm having like writer's block. She said, I'll be right there. And so she came and picked me up at the studio, and she wanted to take me to a strip club. Kind of opened my mind up a little bit. But the neighborhood we were in, it was a pretty sketchy strip club.
Uh-huh.
So we ended up just going to like this old hotel and drinking like tequila. And then she dropped me back off the studio, and the song was written in a matter of like 30 minutes and went in and recorded it.
Wow, that's
so
amazing.
For all the young kids out there.
Yeah, I know, yeah. That's what you need to do, right?
Tequila.
Going back to the album as well, I noticed on a few of the tracks when I was sort of walking around listening to it around London, there's some wonderful like grooves in there as well. And a lot of the songs start with you, don't they, on this one, which I thought it really stood out to me. As there's a slight change. That's going to be quite good for you sort of on the live, isn't it? As everyone's going to be like, you're off the whole way through.
Yeah, it's fun. This current tour we're on right now is definitely the most calories I have ever burned in my entire life during an actual show, because it's just nonstop. But yeah, this record was the first record where we had a producer that, you know, really like was interested in what drum parts were used, as opposed to like, oh, you're the drummer, You played the same, just play what you played on the demo. Like, here we go. We're going to. And Marcus was very, very, I don't want to say pushy, but he was very set and like at least getting you to challenge yourself enough to where if it doesn't work, at least we tried it.
Right.
If it does work, 9 out of 10 times it was stuff that I have played but would have never thought to put it there as opposed to there. And at the end of the record, I was like, man, I'm going to be cussing you every night and have to play these songs like live for the rest of my life. Like, I truly am going to be cursing you. And but then muscle memory and all that fun stuff. And now I'm absolutely loving it. Like, this is, let's say this and Aha Shake are probably my two favorite records to play live that, that we've recorded.
Nice. So you've got the rest of the tour coming up very shortly, as we said, Newcastle tomorrow night as well. Then you've got, you're playing Hyde Park, British Summertime this summer, which will be amazing. Pixies in support, which is a lovely billing, isn't it? Nathaniel Ratliff as well.
Yeah, that's going to be unreal.
Did you choose Pixies, or was that just a brilliant coincidence?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
We never thought that they would say yes.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's like one of our favorite bands ever. Mm. And so the fact that we're going to be sharing the stage with them is incredible. Very excited about that.
Yeah.
And also just the Hyde Park show is always so much fun, and you get to bring like a bunch of different bands.
Yeah.
Because I think there are a couple of other stages and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. It's like our own little mini festival, which,
so you're helping curate and put it all together,
There'll be like 50 people from Tennessee that'll be there. Like, all of our friends and family will come. So for us, it is like we get to have that park for a day and bring all of our friends and ask incredible bands to play, and sometimes they say yes, so...
And it's fun. When
was fun for us.
When we first started, our goal truly was to sell 10,000 records.
Right.
And we said if we play one show a year and charge like $50 a ticket and all 10,000 of those people come, then that's our band right there. So, and that was truly like early on, we're like, okay, that's a good goal to set.
Yeah.
And yesterday walking through Hyde Park with my wife going to lunch, and they're laying the sod down, I guess, for the summer. And she was just like grinning from ear to ear, like, and I was like, what are you smiling at? It was windy and cold and miserable. And she was like, can you believe that there are going to be people like around where we're at right now? She said there are going to be nothing but people surrounding us right now.
Uh-huh.
She was like, do you ever even think of that? And I was like, well, not until now, but now I'm going to be nervous until June. Now, but thank you for bringing that to my attention. But it was pretty neat to look at it from that perspective of walking across and just seeing how big that is, and to think that there are that many people that, you know, enjoy, we get paid to do what we would do for free and just love. Not that we're playing Hyde Park for free, by the way. But we really enjoy it.
And I know from just being friends with a few musicians who have written some beautiful albums, often people, because of the way that the singles sort of roll out, they don't hear album tracks that you're particularly proud of. If there was one album track off Walls that you'd like people to hear, which one would that be? Because we'll play it.
I'm a big fan of Muchacho. I think it's just a...
That's like track 4 or 5, isn't it?
It was written very quickly, and it was like something that was very heartfelt, and it was just one of those that we didn't have to like overthink, and it came out perfect, in my opinion.
Mm. And there's a bit you can... Is that the whistle? There's a whistle towards the end. Yeah,
that happens live too.
Yeah.
Not as perfectly as on the album.
How many whistle takes was there?
Me. And, you know, if the crowd starts whistling too, it's kind of like a dog whistle where you're just kind of going, no one's quite hitting it.
Yeah, yeah. Perfect. Well, thank you so much. I love the LP, as
thank
ever.
You
and it's lovely to see
us.
You. And have a fabulous tour.